I'm particularly honored to have our two print people here so they can verify all the things that I'm saying about print. Now, before I get started, can we get some ideas on what print is? Does anybody want to throw out anything besides something on a piece of paper?
Brochures, newsletters, postcards, writing things.
Okay. Anything else?
Newspapers,
magazines. Actually, print is anything that you can touch. A billboard is print. A t-shirt is print. Pens are print. Something that you can touch and keep. So, yeah, this is my new logo. I've just transitioned to it. So if you see some materials that have something different on it, it's only because I'm in transition. The power of print. Let's start out with why print is so powerful, and I'm sure everyone has heard that print is dead. Well, it's further from the truth. Print was up 30% last year, and it continues to grow. It's also the third largest manufacturing business in the country. So, the power of print, the big thing is that print registers in a different part of your brain, making it more memorable, more real, and more impactful. If you touch something, or you see it here, it's more memorable. Secondly, print has a continuing impact. If you get a postcard in the mail, you can refer back to it if you're interested in it. If you have a newspaper, oh yeah, I saw that ad on that heater, you know, getting my heater fixed, and your heater breaks, you can go refer back to it. It offers more space to work with. With print, however, you want to have one focus, and I'm sure that you can verify that. People try to put too much in a newspaper ad or a magazine ad. You want a strong headline and a lot of focus on that headline, and then the other stuff follows, all the other details follow. It offers more flexibility. Can do all sorts of shapes and sizes. You've got books, you've got foldover cards, you have postcards, you have business cards, you have information pieces, and they come in all shapes and sizes. I've got coasters, I have round business cards, oval business cards. You can put something in an envelope. There's just thousands of options. And if you can touch it, as I mentioned before, it's print. So here's just some print work that I've done in the past. This is a booklet I did for a metal roof company. This is a t-shirt design I did for a physical therapy company. A logo that I did for a cupcake company, and they've also used this for a label on their packaging. A directory for the chamber. You had a great event last night. Sorry I wasn't there. This is actually a friend of mine who's been doing pottery for 30 years. And for her birthday, I designed these business cards for her. And she sells on Etsy and at fairs. Guess how much her repeat business increased by just adding these business cards? 50%. Yeah, so if you're selling something tangible and you're not putting a business card or a sticker on it, you're missing an opportunity. She actually went one step further and put some of the features of her pottery in there, that is, like, you can bake it in the oven and it's dishwasher safe. And again, she got more repeat orders and more referrals from her existing customers simply by adding these two pieces to her products.
Lori, I did have to mention pens. I always get pen or a doer, and my doer is the stylus on the end, because more people love that. So,
yes, absolutely.
And your pen is always, that pen is always there, and it makes
you. Yeah, absolutely.
So on those little card sheets, so somebody buys, she's got little, oh, by the way, we do this kind of stuff too.
So you know the power of that. Absolutely. And forgive me, but if you do have questions or you want to interject something like she did, just please
before you forget.
Yeah. Oh, we don't forget.
No.
Brochures, which you mentioned before. These are really popular now because people are so busy. It's called a wrap card. It's just a front and back of a card. It's a little bit skinnier and tall. I do a lot of wrap cards now. And actually, you can put them in a business envelope. And as she mentioned, I specialize in restaurant menus. About 68% of my business is designing restaurant menus. I also do banners, which is also print. This is a before and after. I don't know if you've heard of the Bavarian Inn in Frankenmuth, but I live there than you. And I do cards. This happens to be a Thanksgiving card for a men's clothing store. Even something as simple as a race entry form. You need to have a good design and the headlines at the top and then all the other information. Newspaper ads. Encourage people to like you on Facebook. Okay, so typically print readers are more educated, and more education often equates into more income. It's not always the case, but like with anything, it's most. Print readers have a longer attention span, and unplugging is in right now. I heard somebody mention something about mindfulness and being in the moment as opposed to thinking about what you have to do next today. We're here gathering information about. Okay, so if you're reading on paper, and I'm sure that you've felt this before, I get on the screen and I look at this long article and I'm like, I'm gonna print this. So then I read it on a piece of paper and then I can highlight what I need. So reading is on paper is slower and deeper, and readers remember more. So just keep that in mind. I'm not saying there's not a place in the world for digital, because there certainly is. And with any marketing campaign, it's a media mix. You've got to do a lot of different things to catch them. So higher comprehension and recall stimulates emotions and desires, particularly if you touch something. It's a multi-dimensional experience. Slower reading speeds, it's preferred by a majority of people, even millennials. More focused attention, and you have less distraction. Have you been doing a search on your phone, and then a pop-up comes in, and then got a text message come in, and you forget what you were actually looking for? Often that interrupted makes it difficult to retain that information. And our minds are actually changing in this digital age, and there's a lot of studies out about how our minds are changing, and the jury is still out. Are we assimilating enough information digitally? That's why print continues to do so well. And finally, it drives sensory involvement, which contributes to its impact on readers. So a lot of repeat here. Paper-based reading is slower and more deliberate. Paper offers more focused attention and less distraction. It's associated with a better transfer to your long-term memory and clearer comprehension. And memory comprehension, again, is enriched by multi-sensory experience of touching. Yes?
One of the things I do is I get magazines in and I scan the magazine. If there's an article in there I want, I take that article out, and the magazine goes that way. That way I don't have to say, well, what did I see that magazine for?
Right.
What you kept is the essence of what you want to read.
Right, absolutely. So you'll go through it the first time and then maybe go through or mark it, or you're saying you tear the articles out.
And now send the complete odds. If I find something like that, I'll make a copy of it. But I do not like to tear up print, and that's probably because I didn't have a lot of books growing up and you never damaged a book or anything. But that's just the way you think about it. Going through the boundary or whatever.
Right. Okay, so then this is the neuroscience behind technology. As I mentioned before, it may be rewiring our brain in negative ways so that we're not retaining stuff because we're you, I'm working at the computer, and all of a sudden I have a pop-up over here of an email coming in, and then my phone rings, and I got a phone call, and then somebody has got a messenger message for me, and like, what was I doing? You know, I lost track of it. So we really do, we are all in transition, and the jury's still out. Okay, so hyperlinks distract us from taking in a logical flow of linear information. That's one of the things about print, is you're holding it in your hand, and people say with direct mail you have 4 seconds. So, but at least you get 4 seconds. Sometimes you don't even get 4 seconds when you're on your phone without an interrupt. It undermines our ability to comprehend and remember. The level of interrupt is overwhelming in the digital area, and reading online, if you're reading an article online, and I'm sure that you are all aware of this, you just kind of scan it, and you're looking just for tips, and in fact, that's one of the techniques in designing a website, lots of bullets, because that's what people are doing, is they're scanning information. So I added a couple of these things because I thought they were very good for any business. If I've gone into a business and they want like a brochure and their sign is terrible, I will recommend them to redo their sign. I think that's one of the best forms of advertising, is an exterior sign in a business. And for me, I had my vehicle wrapped. That was fabulous. It was worth every penny I put into it. So on average, if you add an additional sign to your premises, your annual sales revenue will go up 4.75%. Now, a number of you don't have storefronts. You're doing sales. Again, those leaving those printed pieces can help you. That's kind of your sign. Another thing, like if you have the potential to use yard signs, that's another thing. You'll reach 50 to 60 times more readers with those signs. And 85% of customers live or work within a 5-mile radius of your business. Often, we spend a lot of time and effort on people that are really far away, and it's hard to build those relationships, and that grew in this slide just for that reason. That doesn't mean that you can't have customers all over the nation, and I'm sure with Jackie you guys do, but the focus of the majority of your business usually is within 5-mile radius. Okay, baby boomers are the largest group of consumers that show more trust in print. So if your demographic is baby boomers, do not ignore print. Okay, so then some tips to grow your business. Do we have any questions about the neuroscience and the readability and the memory section? Because this is a whole new section. All right, so growing your business. There's two ways to grow your business. One is to get new customers, and the second way is to get existing customers to refer you or buy more. So most businesses are relationships, and so you want to build those relationships so they keep those clients forever, and you want to consistently be in front of them. Now there's two types. Typically there's business to consumer, which would be going to a local coffee shop, going to Target or Home Depot, and then there's business to business, and certainly the newspaper and the magazine are business to business. So keep in mind what type of business that you have. You have office furniture, you're business to business. So you would approach marketing in different ways for different types of businesses. The gentleman that told me about this seminar is Manesh Baxi, and he is one of my coaches, and he helped me grow my business by building relationships, and he gave me a lot of tips, and he today is offering you all the option to get his free book, 100K Income Mastery, and you have a sheet in front of you that the last item there is you check that. You put down your address, he will mail you a copy of this. Paying attention to your customers and building those relationships on a daily basis is critical for the business growth. And I followed his steps, and my business increased by 100% within one year. So that's just a little bonus here that he offered today. Okay, the power of the thank you. I think the whole idea of thank you notes has gone by the wayside. I send out regular thank you notes, and I get thank you notes for my thank you notes. Because it's like a dinosaur in this world. People don't take the time. They whip off an email or a text, and many times that's okay. But many times it isn't. You need to go beyond that to build those relationships. And so that's one of the ways that I've grown my business is by that personal thank you. And I actually have custom thank you notes, and I do recommend them. This is my thank you note. The stuff there is on the bottom, is upside down, because that's the back of the card. I have one here. So I have thank you for your referrals. Thank you for your business. Thank you for any number of things. And again, I know you're doing, who's doing send out cards? Okay. I love send out cards, and often I'll send my clients the logo I've designed on the front or a picture of them, but they have proven that if you personally don't touch it before it goes out in the mail, it has less impact than if you actually touch it, sign it, and put it in the envelope. And then a couple of tips about that. If you put the stamp a little bit crooked and you put it in a colored envelope, it seems more personal than it is. Perfect. So don't worry about getting your stamp perfect. And even one step further, if you can go get those big stamps, so that it's not just flags that everybody does. All those little things make a difference. So there's thousands of ways to say thank you. But one of the things that I do regularly is I have these little stickers that if I give somebody a gift card, if I'm sending out an envelope, I put the sticker on the back, so you continually reinforce your brand.
I heard one time that if you send an envelope about the size of a graduation or a wedding announcement, your opening is by 90%.
Yeah. It's actually 97, especially if it's hand-addressed. If you can hand-address something, it's a lot more powerful than. And if you don't hand-address it, you use a handwriting font instead of just a serif font, you have a better open rate too. There's a lot of little tricks.
Curiosity.
Yes. business cards, make sure you include your business card with anything, and you can actually put a custom imprinted piece with your information. Again, this is what this potter did with hers. This is a realtor that she had little things with her .com on them and put it on a gift basket. I brought this one here. This is another thing that I do for my clients. Thank you, a latte, and it has a little latte thing in there, and it's got my website on there, and it's right down the front to promote. Do everything you can to promote your business. So there's a picture. Go ahead.
I think so significant, the real estate people do it, but a business card with a pitch on it. Because 2 days later, you look at the business card and you're trying to figure out who is that person. But a pitch is other.
That's a good idea. Yeah, particularly if you're in the business of selling yourself. realtors, as you mentioned. Every year I do Thanksgiving cards, which is another way of saying thank you. In the holiday mix of mail, I know less people are doing Christmas cards than used to, but I've always done Thanksgiving cards, and everybody does that. So again, get a lot of bang for your buck with a Thanksgiving card. Again, this is upside down because this is a folded piece, and you've got, you know, the front and the back. Yes.
Is there some reason for the expensive cards? Does it make a difference?
Yes.
Maybe I missed that part.
I don't know that I've actually gone to that, but yes. As long as you brought it up, I have probably 30 different cards because there's all sorts of options, and I'll send them around for you to see. The ones that you have there are called painted edge cards. They're available in like 13 different colors, so they would match your brand. I have a plastic card that's translucent. Bless you. I have a silk card with raised lettering on it. And once you feel it, you're going to like, wow, this is cool. I have a thicker card without a painted edge. I have foil cards. And I have circular cards, I have coasters. I mean, this is my business, I better have these, right? And I have stickers, which I told you about. I have, you know, one-sided card, if somebody wants to write on the back, then I've got that. And I think that's all I brought today. But I'll pass these around, put the silk one on the top so that you can touch that. I have found passing out business cards for 30 years, and I've had a lot of different designs. These painted cards and the translucent plastic ones get the most people that say, wow, this is really cool. So if they say that, it's a lot more impactful. So, and people tend to keep them.
Lori, I do have to say, probably always, probably not 10 years ago, maybe longer, I have heard about putting a picture on the card. And you know, we put a picture on a card, and I still have people who will say, I never could throw your card away. And it's because people do not like to throw away a picture. It's proven for some reason.
I get that.
Yeah.
I get that. How many people in this room have their picture on their card? Well, obviously you do.
Yeah, no.
Okay, so then obviously I do Christmas cards, and I try to send them out early in the season so they don't get lost in the rush. And then thank you for your referral. I have a referral program for my customers. If you don't have a referral program, I recommend it. I have probably 20 people that regularly give me referrals. Some of them are customers, some of them are not. In fact, I have a credit union up there in the Grand Lake area that is not a customer of mine, but they're one of my best referral sources. Because credit unions are business to business.
What do you usually offer for a referral?
If a customer gets me business, I typically will give them a $10 gift card. If it's a big piece of business, like if it's a restaurant, you know, usually it's 25, or sometimes I'll give them a percentage of the sale. It just depends. And I also put that on my list in front of you on the evaluation sheet there, if you want to be part of the referral program. Okay, so we have another break. Here is, were there any questions there about thank yous and how and other ideas that people have had to say thank you to customers? All right. In front of you is a yellow card. If you open that, this is one of my direct mail pieces. As I mentioned, that direct mail is one of my top sales. And this one is, I send out to all my customers, and it's forget-me-not, and it has seeds in it. If you have something in a colored envelope, it's more likely to get opened. If it has something interesting on the inside, like those seeds kind of jiggle, I got so much feedback on this piece. And again, on the inside of it, it promotes my, the things that I can do to help you with your business, whether it's business cards or postcards.
So this sounds, I'm wondering about fragrance, is that good or bad?
Oh, I think anything that's interesting that gets them to open it is good. I know one time I did a thick card and just put a glue dot on it, so it was a little bit thicker. That was another thing. I've done candy bars, also anything that's more than just a plain piece of paper. And you certainly hope that your customers never forget you. This is something that can be done on a small scale if you have your furniture company, you have businesses you haven't heard from for a while and you want to do 50 of them, or you can do thousands of them. I would say probably 20% of my business comes from these oversized postcards. I call them symbol cards. The largest size envelope you can run in the mail with regular postage is the 6x11 size. Everybody thinks that this costs a lot more, but it really doesn't cost the same size as anything else yet.
One thing about when you're putting items into envelopes, you should try them by sending them to yourself first. Because I had an agency friend, an insurance agency friend, who had this idea of putting aspirin, packet aspirins, into envelopes to take away the headache. And of course, they broke open, and the post office had white powder, and that did not go over. So you need to really test it for yourself before you ever use it.
That is exactly true. And being in business for 30 years, I can't tell you all the interesting things that happen. If you have a square envelope, it's not rectangular, it costs more. And I actually went to the post office for a job for Catholic Charities, which is one of the largest nonprofits in the nation. I had no idea of that. And the post office told me exactly how much it would cost to send. We sent out, I think, a couple thousand of them, and most of them came back because it wasn't my post office, it was their post office that rejected me. So that was a problem to work out. But that is great advice. If you're doing something, especially if it's a little bit thicker, send it to yourself so that you can eliminate any problems. So there's three ways of really doing direct mail. Number one is if you put a stamp on it and do it yourself. Number two is, you know, bulk mail, which is what a lot of my customers do. Number three is a relatively new program with the post office called Every Door Direct. And if you are marketing to customers in your vicinity of your business, Every Door Direct offers a great alternative, and it's a lot less money. I believe it's 17.7 cents a piece, and you have a minimum of 500, a maximum of 5,000 that you can mail at a time, and certainly 17.7 cents is a lot less than bulk, which can be 22 to 29, and a lot less at 49, which is the cost of the stamp. Anyone is remotely interested in bulk mail or direct mail, and you want some information, you can contact me, and I'm happy to help any way that I can. So, the oversized postcard. Okay, so now we're going to get into some common direct mail mistakes that people make. And what would you think would be the biggest mistake people would make? Well, obviously, you probably never read it, right? It isn't anything to do with the design or the offer or the logo. It's the list. Okay, you have to go back to who is your target audience. Yep. So if you're marketing to high-end men's clothing, you're not going to mail these to millennials. You're not going to mail them to low-income housing, you have to get a list that's qualified for you. Now, you can buy a list, and I can help you buy a list, and certainly there's lists available for almost anything that you would want. I have customers that want just doctors. That's a very expensive list. It's about the only one that is particularly expensive. Most of them are not, but you can get Christians with income about 100,000 plus, with two children and a dog, and you can get two in these zip codes. And that's often what people will want. They can narrow down their customers that much. And so why pay 22-29 cents for a piece when it isn't your target audience? Number one, okay, so focus on a feature. That's a negative. You want to talk about benefits. How can people benefit from your product? Tom?
Yep.
He asked me, what would you pay to be 10 years younger? This is a benefit. And be sure, if you can put the you in your headline, it's much better. But in that case, you could be 10 years younger in a certain amount of time. So then the you is implied. But make sure you talk about the benefits of your product, not the features. This chair has wheels and a nice cushy seat. You might say, eliminate back problems at work.
That's really one of the biggest draws.
Okay.
There's a back hurt.
Yeah, absolutely. So talk about the benefits. Not having an offer, I can't tell you how many pieces in the mail I get, and there's nothing that gets me to move. You've got to have an offer. And you have to make it crystal clear what you want them to do. In this case, we're having a clearance sale, we want you to come in and take advantage, and make sure you close with a call to action. Call today, come in today. If you don't do that, sometimes they won't do it. Just make sure you close that gap. Start with the product, so you want to start with the prospect. What is it that you're offering them, and design your piece from their perspective. How are you going to get them to move?
Yeah, one of the things they talk about is the fear of loss. Oh, the sale's over Wednesday. I had to hurry up and get in there.
Right. That's exactly right.
That's what Kohl's does.
Hurry for best selection.
Mm-hmm. And then you come in and you buy, and then they'll give you a $10 coupon for spending so much, and then you have to go back because you have $10.
Kohl's is notorious for that, aren't they? And the very last one is creating direct mail by committee. Help creating anything by committee. I've had to design logos for committees, and I learned long ago, find out who the decision makers are. If it's a dozen people, I'm not interested. I'm sorry. It's just too, everybody has their own opinion. So if there's two decision makers and then the committee is going to filter it, that's okay. They're all voting, it's off the menu. I'm sorry.
Created by a committee.
Okay. And so the tips for best direct mail, as I mentioned before, if you hand address your envelopes, and if you can't hand address them, a handwritten font, put it in a colored envelope, use a stamp instead of bulk mail. And they do have bulk mail stamps, so that is actually an option. KISS, which is keep it simple, you have 4 seconds to catch somebody's attention. You better do it quick. If they're interested, they'll read all the details, but if they're not interested, you've lost them. And intrigue them, as I mentioned, with the seeds or dimension or anything. So there's another piece that I did as a postcard of clients I had not heard from in a year. I sent this out to them, and I got response. Often we're still out there trying to get the next new client instead of cultivating the people we already have relationships with that already love us. So keep that in mind. And this is my very best direct mail piece that I've ever done and ever gotten business from. And this is suggested by my coach, and so I give him all the credit. I'm sorry I didn't think of it. As I mentioned, 68% of my business comes from restaurants. Get a taste of creative menu design. It goes in a yellow envelope. On the top is samples of my work. On the right and left, I'm sorry, is my testimonial from one of my customers. And here's the copy for a call to action. And I get calls every week from these. I got a call yesterday. I have your card. And I happen to put my plastic card inside there. This is the coolest guy I've ever seen. Actually, a restaurant chain that owns 9 locations called me and said, this has been sitting on my desk for a year. And I'm ready to change my menu. So.
And what I love about that is you have black lettering on white background. Because sometimes when you get things, you can't really read what they're, they'll put like a provocative green
sure.
color with white letters, and you can't read it.
Actually, if there's a lot of copy, white type on black is hard to read. But if you're not doing a lot of copy, it's okay. If I'll pass this around. If anybody wants one, you can take one, or you can at least see it.
What are better colors to use? Is it white on black and RGB?
Well, I'm not. If you have a whole block of type, it's harder to read white ink on that. If you have a block of type, the best lettering to use or the best font is a serif font. That's the one with the feet in the top and the bottom. And it's, black ink on a white background. But, if you've got a sign or your different business, I guess I can get into that just a second. What is your question?
Are you mailing these or just handing these out?
No, I mail them.
Mail.
Yeah, I just mail them to all the restaurants that are non-franchisees. Just pick an area and off it goes. So I do 12 of them every week.
Did you say white lettering on black background is a better one to read?
No. Black lettering on a white background is easier to read if you're doing a big block of type.
Small areas.
If you're doing a sign and people are driving fast going back, your best fonts are sans serif, the ones without the feet, and the best colors are black and yellow, black and white, or red and white. So for readability, those are the best colors. But we could actually go into the psychology of color. It depends on your business.
I've heard black is a good color, yellow is a good color, but blue is the color that everyone, if you have black and I have black and yellow, mm-hmm. but I know that blue in there, because just blue is something with America maybe and everything, but that blue, just a little bit of blue in yellow, I've heard people go to that blue before they go to yours, which is almost exactly the same.
The number one color for appeal is blue. But if you're in the restaurant business, blue denotes mold on your food, so you don't really want to use blue with food. If you're a dentist, you don't want to use red.
No
because
way.
People are thinking blood, So you have to be mindful of what your business is and the colors that you can use. Black is typically like a luxury color. Shackley green, it's more environmental and natural. The tans and the, are also natural. Any other? Did you have a question? What specifically is your business?
Insurance.
Okay. So blue would probably reds. The most popular color is blue, and the most dominant color is red for logo use. And if you're going to do a logo, you bet. It's better to have at least 2 colors than one, as a general. Okay, so there's the inside of it. Okay, I already did the business card thing. Somebody had a question about it. But my personal feeling is make sure you stand out. Whatever it takes, I have these business cards with the round tops. I have round business cards. I have these little square business cards. A lot of people complain about these because they're not the same size and shape as everybody else, but they, you know, people notice them because they're different. And different is good because it makes you more memorable. Presentation folders, if you are selling a high ticket item or you're trying to build a relationship like Mark, he put a presentation folder down there. This is a realtor that uses presentation folders. Okay, this, and I'm sure you will agree with me, I could preach on being consistent all day. I can't tell you how many times people will tell me, I don't have a logo, just use anything. Oh my gosh, don't say that to me. Consistency is so important. That's why people like businesses like Shackley have branding books, pages and pages of information on how to use their brand. Are you with a big insurance company or are you an independent?
I work for an agency.
An agency, okay. Is it an independent or is it like?
Yes.
Okay. So, like the State Farms and the Farm Bureaus, they all have branding material.
And Dave's agency, we have a really nice little KSP.
Okay.
So everybody knows cards.
Okay.
KSP.
Okay.
Always remember.
So, what colors are your logo?
Yeah, it's blue. Blue and blue.
Okay, so yes, you have a nice logo, and obviously you guys use this consistently.
You did a lot of it.
Yeah. I
can't remember.
No, I inherited it.
Okay, can I keep this? This is very nice. Very nice. Again, as I mentioned, be sure if you've got a logo to use it, to use it on everything. I have these little boxes that I brought, think out of the box, and I actually passed around all those business cards. So be consistent. Take advantage of every opportunity you can to touch those top clients and referral resources. I actually have a retention campaign that I drop every quarter. The seed one was the last one I did in... at St. Patrick's Day, lucky to have you as a client, and everybody got a lottery ticket. So just something in it that makes you stand out. And I got something in the mail from a funeral home, and I know we have a funeral home here. I won the best of the best for Grand Blanc. And this funeral home sent me a personal letter congratulating me on this award. Now, there were hundreds of people that got the awards, but they took advantage of that opportunity, which I thought was really a great idea. Maybe I'll do that next year. And that brings me to the next thing, is if somebody does something that's cool, steal it. I mean, you're not really stealing it, but copy the idea. I mean, don't use it verbatim. And I forgot your name, Sandy. Okay, she also asked me about emails, that she had trouble writing copy. And the same thing is true for emails. If you see a subject line that really intrigues you, and you might be able to change it a little bit for your business to get somebody to open, the most important thing on an email are the first two words of that subject line, because it's your business name, Thomason Design and Advertising, and get stuck on us. And that's one that I use for stickers. So anything to be intriguing. When you're designing anything, if you end up doing design yourself, just keep it simple. Don't try to chunk it all up. Make sure you have a big headline at the top that's strong. Motivational headline. Again, as I mentioned before, put your customer in the copy.
I did want to mention that they always said also, well, this has to do with email, but if you're sending something, an email out, and it only has to be a little bit of information, like, yes, I'll attend that such and such. You don't have to get in the subject line. Put it in the subject, and you don't have to put anything else in the body of it. and then it's not so wordy.
Right.
I can go right away. I don't like to receive emails that says no subject, because I'm like,
yeah.
Who could this be?
Yeah, the subject line is critical. Make it flow. People go through a piece, and I don't think I have a flyer on me, in a Z pattern. So let's say, for example, this ad, you want to have a headline and then make them pull through. That's a backward Z. This is more of an image ad than it would be motivating somebody to do something, because there's really no headline to capture your attention. Make it exciting and interesting, and always include a call to action. What do you want them to do? Call me today. Stop by today. Email me for more information. Whatever you want them to do, make sure you say it. Oh, this is a flyer. Run in for great savings. The you is implied. Mm-hmm. And again, discount and close. Do you have a question?
I just wanted to make a comment. One thing that I learned about writing copy is when you're using words and you're making bold words throughout your paragraphs, when you're all done, read those bold words. Make sure you're not giving some sort of a conflicting message. Make sure those bold words all flow together, because sometimes that's the only thing they look at.
You're absolutely right. There's a wall of copy. People might not read the whole wall of copy. That's why you want to bold the most important things. And if you're doing a letter like that, the postscript is the number one red item. So make sure you include a PS if you're writing a letter to a client.
Do a PS.
Okay, so now we're going to have a little bit of fun. Mm-hmm. I have custom wrapped candy bars that I. And so you guys are going to get all chocolated up today. These happen to be Tomlinson Design. Don't chocolate, not Hershey's. But you might find Hershey's inside. Okay. Does anybody want to name one of the top 10 brands in the U.S. of the largest animals?
Nope.
Coca-Cola is, who said that? You did. Okay, good job. Anybody else?
Geico.
I thought that too. No?
Ford Motor Company?
I believe that they are. And if not, they're in the top 12.
Yeah. What was yours?
I was going to say Ford. So
Ford, yeah. Okay.
Budweiser, no?
I don't mind.
No?
General Motors.
A division of General Motors.
Chevrolet.
They definitely are.
Was Ford?
Yeah, somebody already said Ford.
Oh, did it?
Okay, so one of the luxury brands, a couple luxury brands are in the top.
Mercedes.
No?
They went to Jerry's.
Yeah.
No? Not cars.
Oh.
So, some of the women may get these.
Calvin Klein?
Well, you're on the right track.
Victoria's Secret?
No. The number one is a baby item.
Geico?
Johnson & Johnson.
Gerber. Procter & Gamble. Johnson & Johnson.
No.
Baby item?
So,
Huggies?
No, so.
Pampers?
Pampers.
Yeah.
Who said that? Yep. And actually, Forbes voted, made Pampers the 50th most valuable brand in the nation. Here's your top 10.
Amazon.
Pampers, Gillette. I mean, there's been a recent razor company that has just taken itsy bitsy part of Gillette. But they own a big portion of that market. L'Oreal, Louis Vuitton.
Is that Amazon? Is that
Louis Vuitton has branched out purses, clothing. Shoes, I think. Yeah, my whole wardrobe is not. Okay, so this is my son just moved to LA to get his master's, and my daughter and I went out there, and for the weekend we were doing a lot of quizzes on our phone. Top 10 this and top 10 that. This is one of the quizzes we did, so I'm sure.
You went down Rodeo Drive,
Ventura Highway, I know that because we're singing the song from America. That was really fun. Okay. Does anybody know the hidden graphic in the index?
It's an arrow.
It's the arrow. There is an arrow in between the E and the X there. I read an article in a magazine many, many years ago. This used to be Federal Express. And people would call it FedEx, so they finally went with the world and changed it to FedEx. And they designed it with the arrow because they moved packages forward. So, and keep that in mind with anything that you design. You want to keep your eye going into the copy. If you're doing an ad with a person in it, make sure your person is facing the copy. So, you can, of course, put
that. Well, if you're sending a package type promotion to your clients, make sure you know what shipping company you're using. I recently purchased a book on Facebook Market out of eBay. And I got the routing, and the routing went from Massachusetts to, it went between Detroit and Arkansas four times. It took over 30 days before I got the package. And it was because the shipper used the same tracking number on 800 packages. And you can imagine 800 customers ticked off because they, and of course, what I bought another one, and I just set put a label on the front of it, return to sender, not accepted by addressee, because you get it a month late.
Right. That's amazing. That was amazing.
So make sure you know your automated shipping company.
Does anybody know any other logos with hidden graphics in them?
Wendy's.
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 That's
not
in
what I
the necklace. Or it says mom, M-O-M.
Oh, it does.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that. Okay, great. Wendy's logo
Baskin
says
Robbins.
Mom. Mm-hmm. Yes, very good.
What did you say?
I just did a presentation yesterday, and one person got one of these, so good job. Baskin Robbins has a 31 in it. Anybody else have any other ideas? Okay, well, this is my favorite one. Tostitos. There's two men holding a chip over us. All the sauces.
How do you know they're
unobserved?
they don't have skirts on.
No skirts.
No, two people. You're right. I stand corrected.
No.
There's your Baskin Robbins has a 31 in it. Jack in the Box is a fish because they're a Christian company. Hope for Africa has a man or a woman looking at a child. The Kisses, there's a kiss, sideways kiss between the K and the I. And the Big Ten has an 11 in the middle. Pittsburgh Zoo has a gorilla. Toblerone has a bear in there. The Milwaukee Brewers has a glove and a ball. And I think United Methodist is a dove.
Yeah,
a Bible and a robe and flames and a cross.
What's that? What are the kisses?
The kisses between the K and the I. It's the, you see it sideways kiss?
Yeah.
A sideways Hershey.
Oh, yeah.
Sideways Hershey.
We're looking for the Bible.
The Bible is this right in here.
Okay.
It's an open Bible. That's exactly it. So that's kind of fun. My daughter sent me this out at home. What industries consistently spend the most on advertising?
Automotive.
And the second one, anybody that watches a lot of TV, these annoying ads regarding pharmaceuticals. Okay. Oh, so here, you got a candy bar for your Baskin Robbins.
And you guessed pharmaceuticals? And who guessed automotive over here?
Over here.
Okay. Is there anybody else I didn't give a candy bar to that?
I didn't get my FedEx candy bar.
Oh.
Now I have three candy bars.
Thank you for reminding me. I got so
distracted. You were. Yeah, you weren't getting out of here without giving me a
job. Okay, and what is the best type of brand to use for print? What brand, what type of business is consistently a print user? Think about the demographic. It's baby boomers. It's educated people. It's
I would say something with environment, trees.
High income.
Jewelry?
It's luxury brand. Who said jewelry?
Or candy bars.
Yeah.
A luxury brand is typically will use print. And that's why you see so a lot of magazines. Okay, so the last part of my presentation is about doing a marketing plan. I can't encourage you to